Everybody, how have you been? This is Chasing Spindles, my life being crappy at everything crafty. This is show number 4. It has been 7 months. If you are new, hello and welcome. If you're returning, thank you for sticking with me throughout my long, long absence. I am Sasha, also known as Spin Pixie, everywhere on the interwebs, and you can find the blog for this show at chasingspindles.blogspot.com. You can also find me on everywhere as Spin Pixie, Twitter, I don't have a Twitter yet, Plurk, Instagram, Ravelry. I am on there as Spin Pixie. There is a group in Ravelry called Chasing Spindles for the podcast. Please feel free to join and tell a friend. And so thanks for being with me. And I have a lot to show you. It's been a long 7 months. I don't have the format. I'll try and stick to as much of it as I can recall. But it was on my old computer. I'll get into that in just a minute. So because there's so much show, I'll try to keep it as short as possible. A lot of it will be babble in the beginning, but I will try and keep it as spinning and knitting centric as I can. It's been a huge 7 months for me. So let's go ahead and get into some of that. First of all, we'll start off with the fact that I no longer live in Los Angeles like I used to. I am about 2 hours, depending on traffic, away from there. And I am living in the, the desert or whatever you want to call it, by the mountains. I live 2 hours away from where I used to live. Long story short with that, grandparents did a reversed mortgage. Grandmother has since passed, and grandfather no longer lives in the house, meaning that we had to give their house to the bank. They sell the house and then dispense the money, however, you know. So that's how that worked. 2 days before I was either going to be homeless or living in a tough shed, my mother found this place on the internet, and we sent out an email. No one ever got back to us. So, because I did not want to live in no tough shed, and it was actually it said it was a house, but then, it said something about being on a slab, and I didn't get what that meant. Anyway, long story short, or shorter, I decided I was going to call the property manager about this place. Ended up speaking to a wonderful lady named Anne, who was, you know, every time we talked, we never talked any shorter than 10 to 15 minutes. And it was always about, like, what she would do for her job, and then, you know, we would always get into talking, like, having conversation. And I figured, in one of our conversations, she told me that for her job, she used to be an animal rescuer, and she told me about how she's opened about 3 shelters, one in this community, or one in her community, and then 2 in Orange County. And she gives spay and neuter advice over the phone. She's just a real champion for animals, so I think that's absolutely amazing. And I just figured, even if I never met her, I just wanted to know her, because she just seemed like such a wonderful lady. Well, it turned out she was the owner of the property I was inquiring about. So we talked, and then she said that I could come out and see the property. One of the things that was a major hurdle is she wanted somebody who was elderly and on Section 8. And I am not an elderly woman and do not have Section 8. But she did make an exception. Then once that was cleared, I had to admit to having a dog and a cat. And she said she would speak to her husband as to whether or not pets were acceptable, and she okayed my dog to come live here, and my cat, if I got the apartment, or if I got the house. We made plans to come out and see it that weekend, and had a contract signed. There was somebody else who was supposed to come and see the property, but we kind of hit it off, and so she was really amazing, and was like, okay, well, let me get the contract, and I signed it right there, and I gave her, part of the deposit, and, was able to move in a couple days later. When I daydream, it's usually about realistic, simple things that it would mean a lot to, would make my life happy, like, the simple things that I want, that would make my life happy. And in all my dreams, I would see this little house, this tiny little one-bedroom house, surrounded by mountains and country and animal noises and stuff like that. And when I walked into this place, I walked over here to the front of the house in the living room. And I looked out the window, and you're going to see a picture of this picture, because it's funny that my mom snapped this picture. Because I remember... the thought that was going through my head when she took this picture. But I walked over and I opened up the curtains and I looked around outside and I was like, holy shit, this is my dream come to life. Like, there are hills that run all along the side and the back of the property. And then I have a neighbor who has ducks and chickens, and I have another neighbor who has horses and stuff like that. And so, I'm constantly surrounded by those things. Like, everything looks pretty much like it did in my dream, in my vision of this place. So, this whole experience with having this place, renting this place, has been amazing. My landlady is awesome. She lives right across the way. And it's, for being my first actual house, I could not have asked for a better experience. I can't see living anywhere different. Like, I would love to move to Portland still. That's still something that I really wanted to do. It just so happened that me and Chaotic Hooker were in different timelines, so that didn't so much happen. But, I mean, eventually I would love to live in Portland. That'd be great. But right now, at least for the next 5 to 10 years, I would love to be here. And I only say that because, you know, who knows what the future will hold. And this is, I think, the first time that I'm not afraid to make a plan. I'm not, you know, conversing with the universe about it just yet, but I mean, I like where I am, and I could not ask for anything. Like, when I did my last show to this show, my life has done a complete 180. I was pretty desolate in thinking about things, and I see a ton of possibility now. So this place has been great for my morale. So there's that. So why hasn't there been a show? Well, it kind of coincides with what I just told you. No time, not enough money, no computer. Those are the three things. Then internet is something that I really haven't had since I moved. I've been using the internet off of my phone to get done the things that I need to get done, but it doesn't really make for fast uploading time to YouTube. So that's why the show has not been here as well. Financially, it's been something that I can't afford, and that has changed, so no computer. My MacBook had water spilled on it. I'm not going to go into the story. I don't blame anybody. I still blame myself, though. Water was spilled on my MacBook, about a fourth of a cup. It still ran perfectly fine. It still turned on. It still turned off. The mouse pad moved after a couple of days of drying. And when it got wet, I was very smart about what I did. I was able to salvage it, and I was pretty proud of that fact. So I went to this company. They were supposed to just fix. All they needed to do was all my computer really needed to have done was I needed them to take it apart and clean it with compressed air professionally. And the reason for that was so that it did not corrode inside. So all I needed them to do is that. And because it's a MacBook, like with a regular PC, you can pop off the battery, clean it out with compressed air. You can do all that and put it back together. But with a MacBook, since it's kind of, there's only little screws on the back. Like everything is behind this panel. So they would have had to take the little screws off and then pop the panel off and then go in and clean everything, take the battery out, clean it all with compressed air, and then be done. That's all that needed to be done. Then I got a call saying that, oh, magically, between your house and my office, which I think this guy works from his basement, between your house and my office, your computer just decided it wasn't going to turn on. And it basically, I don't even want to go into it because I'm just going to get very mad. But it was a nightmare. He broke it. I don't know what he did with it or to it. No longer turns on. It does charge, so the battery's okay. But the actual system, I don't know what he did with it, to it. And he had to replace it. So that is why I am recording on a new MacBook. Because I was ballistic. So, and I mean like a missile. Like I was so upset because MacBooks, not cheap. So, that got remedied, and so that now I am able to do a show. I am here. I could have brought the show back a couple of times, but I didn't want to use it as, like, I didn't want it to be a yo-yo, you know, like, it's here, it's gone, it's here, it's gone. I don't want to do that. So now the show can be back. The show is back, and speaking of the show, let's get into it. I've got spinning, I've got knitting, I've got lessons learned. Yes, I have lessons learned. I have a ton of stuff to show you. Let's just go ahead and get into whippets. Okay, so I have totally not been monogamous. I've been a big ol' knit whore, and I like it. Anyway, there's been a ton of stuff. I have so many things that I've just casted on, so I've kind of got castanitis. So I'll just go through a couple of these things with you. I won't waste your time because a lot of it is really short. So this is, I want to say it's creme de la creme cotton yarn. And I got this at my LYS. When Chaotic Hooker and I went to the Yarn Garden, and these are going to be arm warmers. It is, where I live, it is extremely cold right now. I'm gonna move you, and I will move you back. I apologize. It just so happens that my tail was caught. Okay, sorry. Okay, this is creme de la creme cotton yarn, and I am making some cotton arm warmers. I don't know how these are going to turn out, but I loved the color, and this is the first skein of yarn I actually ever bought myself. So I saw these colors, I saw the way that it was colored and striped and all that, and I don't know why, but I just thought arm warmers. So these are being done on size 8 needles. I have no clue what they are because they were my grandmother's. They could be boy for all I know. I don't know. But I'm trying to knit this so that the stitches kind of open up and you can see them a little more. So what I'm going to try to do is block it out somehow or try to exaggerate the stitches because I think that would look really cute. And I'm just, right now I'm just garter stitching these. So these are just my mindless knitting project when I'm watching podcasts that I feel like I have to watch and I can't just have in the background. So that is that. And this is the ball of yarn I'm using. And the colors, my reds always turn out a little bit more lighter than they are in person. But yeah, I'm really digging these. So that is one thing that I am working on. And I mean, like, I stayed up last night. It had nothing to do with the show and everything to do with the fact that I just had a wild hair or something. But I stayed up all night last night, probably till like 3 in the morning, watching podcasts and knitting. I have been just as bad at watching podcasts as I've been at recording them. So I just needed to have a night where I just ate a bunch of junk I shouldn't have eaten and knit a bunch of stuff I needed to knit. So, sorry about that. I'm all up in your business. Okay. The next thing I'm going to show you is a cowl that I started working on back in August or July. Probably July. This is supposed to be a birthday present for my sister, whose birthday was in August. That didn't happen. I did put it down. I'm glad I put it down, and I'll show you why later. But I became a more advanced knitter, which is why I'm glad I put it down. Long story short. But this is being worked on size, I don't know, needles. Again, circular needles that were my grandmother's. If I had to guess, where did the ones from my, hang on a second, I'm gonna actually try and tell you, those are 8s, I'm gonna guess that these are 7s or 6s, don't ask me who they're by, because I don't know, but I bought some Lion's brand yarn, and I was walking in Target, or something like, I think Target, or Michael's or somewhere, and I just, this yarn kind of caught my eye, and I was like, oh, my sister would love that. So I am making this little stripy cowl, and let me show you what the other side looks like. I don't know if you can see that, but so basically this was just being done in the round in stockinette. But, I learned how to rib, so I'm actually doing 3x3 ribbing. Don't know how that's gonna look, we're just playing with it. And I love the way that ribbing looks, so I'll preface that what I'm about to say by saying that. But I hate ribbing. I hate ribbing. I don't know why, I just think it, maybe it's because I'm so slow at it. And I don't even know why I'm slow at it. I mean, I barely got my speed up on knitting. But ribbing is just so slow for me. I hate it right now. So, but I'm not going to stop doing it because I like the way it looks. But, yeah, I really, really, really hate ribbing. And the chair has my hair. Okay. And then last night I cast it on what I think I'm going to have a ribbed hat. It's just going to be a bunch of ribbing in the round, and it's not even anywhere near worth showing you. I'll show you the ball, because I'll show you what it looks like. This was more of my grandma's yarn. Oh, I didn't even tell you that. Ow. All that is grandma's stash, and grandma left me with more than sufficient amount of yarn and needles and projects that she never finished, and just tons and tons of stuffs I've got to go through. But that's all of it back there. That's all of it. You're not seeing the needles, the hooks, the knitting bag. There's tons of stuff. Just tons and tons of stuff. Oy. So, yeah. Anyway, so these are being done with this yarn. And this is kind of old yarn, so I may have to dye it over again. But I really do like it. We'll see how this plays. You will see it again. And like I said, I just casted it on. I'm not even done with the cast on though. So. And then I will go ahead and show you. I'm not going to show you what I have on the needles right now for my mom. I hope to finish that before I show it to you. So, just give me a couple weeks on that, and I will show you something awesome. Which I may turn into a pattern. It'll be a free pattern, of course, but I may turn it into a pattern because I like the way that it looks, and I think you will too. So, now we're going to go into a special segment in my Whippets. This is kind of like section B, because this is still a work in progress. And I will preface this again by saying this is a podcast for beginners. So if you are a beginner to knitting, spinning, that's totally cool because this podcast is for you. And I like to impart whatever knowledge I've learned because I am still a beginner. And so whatever I can impart to beginners out there, I will. So this is what I like to call lesson learned. Unfortunately. So, I bought this wonderful, beautiful ball of patten wool. This was what I bought when I was on my coffee knit date with Chaotic Hooker. And I left my knitting at home. And because I was 4 hours away from my home, I could not just pop in and go get it. So I bought some needles and some yarn from Michael's. Bought me some patten wool. So pretty. So, I bought that and I decided I would make a hat. And when I was making the hat, this is when I really learned to rib, because I had practiced or played with the ribbing on my Technicowl when I was learning, but it never really came out very pretty. And hang on, I'm having an issue with the yarn. So anyway, it never came out very pretty, but fortunately, when I was knitting on this, Chaotic Hooker told me, you know, well, maybe you should throw some ribbing in there and make it into a hat. And I was like, you know, okay, let's try it. So I started doing a couple of rows, and I asked on Plurk if it looked right. No one really could tell me whether or not it looked right, because I couldn't tell if it was there or not. So I just kind of kept on going. And I loved the way it looked. It looked beautiful. I'd done it right. It is stretchy, and it was... Excuse your chair. It was stretchy, and it was perfect, and it was awesome, and I was done, and oh my god, and then I bound off. I bound off, and I did not have to frog this. Well, I had to restart it because I lost my place horribly and knitted the wrong way. Anyway, I was only two rows in, so I don't count this as having to frog it. I don't know if I've mentioned this to you, and if you're a new viewer, you should know everything I've started, I have had to frog at least once. Some things I have frogged three times or more and started again. So please, if you are frustrated, don't be, because you will learn, And then you will make something which is not done, but you'll make something like this. And it'll be perfect, and it'll be wonderful and beautiful and well-ribbed and stretchy and just look good. But you will not do what I did, because I'll tell you not to do what I did. Beginning knitters who have no common sense, like apparently I do. I don't in the world of knitting. I am a bundle of common sense in real life. Apparently not in knitting. When ribbing, bind off ribbed. Otherwise, all your ribbing is for naught, and the hat will not fit a grown person's head. Oh, I am pissed. I am pissed. I am one of those people who has to knit perfectly, because if I don't knit perfectly, I can't go back. I can't tink back, I can't rip out and start again, I can't fix drop stitches. I have tried, but I don't know, I'm just not good I'm not, I can knit, I can do all the things, I just cannot undo them, or whatever. So, I bound off, and this does not fit anyone. Two saving graces. One, this is wool. So if I wanted to snap the binding and pull it out like that, I could do that and then just wet splice it or spit splice it. But the other thing is, too, I can always unbind it and start again. That's the beautiful thing about binding off. The thing is that I'm not good at doing that, because what happens when I do that, when I have to put my yarn back on the needles, is that I lose stitches and it looks ugly, and I don't want this to look ugly. This is going to be a birthday present for my landlady, who is the lady I spoke of earlier. She is like an amazing friend. So, it's supposed to go like this. It will be a hat. I'm going to gather the top. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take this tail and I'm going to add to it from the ball, which is in the bag. I'm going to add to it from the ball, and then I'm going to sew it in through the end, and then zoop, and then pull it, and then this is going to be the bottom. Unfortunately, yeah, I have to fix it. So my neighbor's birthday was on the 23rd, which was the same day as Kiara Cooker's birthday. And I meant to have this to her by her birthday. That is not going to happen. That did not happen. It will get to her by hook or by crook. And I will get this done. But yeah. So lesson learned. Lesson learned. I in no way... In no way am a perfect knitter. I'm no way a good beginner. The show is called My Life Being Crappy at Everything Crafty. So, you've been warned. So that's that. Now, I think that perhaps we should get into some whirlwind. And then I will talk to you about what I have been spinning. Yeah. Okay. So, in Whirlwind, we have some stuff to show you. I am still on the dreaded merino that I've been spinning since forever now. And, it's so slow going. But I'll tell you a couple of things. First of all, for the beginners watching the show, you will see a lot of YouTube videos on spinning when you're learning, I'm sure, and you're doing your research to whether or not you want to spin. And they will all be spinning beautifully long drawn, or, you know, what they'll do is they'll have their little fiber and they'll spin it and they'll draft and keep on going, and you'll want to spin it and draft and keep on going. But for a beginner, what I would recommend is to take the more relaxed route to spinning, because if you don't, you may become overwhelmed. And I learned this because I realized, after spinning all night last night, that I am spinning wrong for my brain. I like to challenge myself, and I love spinning. I love drop spindling. I really would like to get a wheel now that I've been doing this for some time, and I think that it's no longer a hobby so much as something I love to do, and it's like become a passion of mine. So I think eventually I would love to get a wheel. Now, I'm not going to show you what's on the cop just yet, but I will show you something else. If you're a beginner, what I would recommend doing is drafting out your yarn, and then taking, especially if you have a sticky fiber like merino. And if you've never spun merino, it's like cat or dog hair. It just sticks to everything and it gets everywhere. And I have walked out with trails of merino down my arm because it's gotten stuck to what I'm wearing. And it gets everywhere. everywhere. I would prefer spinning merino a lot more if I had a wheel, because I think it would be less messy that way. But I still would like to spin it. I'm still going to spin it, obviously. But what I would recommend to you if you're a beginner is to draft out a piece of merino and just really spin it slowly, or whatever fiber you're spinning. Spin it, like, take a piece like this. And I've seen certain people do it, but take a small piece like this. Just take a tiny piece like that and draft it a little bit, and then just start spinning like this with a small piece. Don't be in a huge rush to keep on long drawing or anything like that. And please don't think that makes you a not good spinner or a poor spinner because you do that. Get used to joining. Don't be afraid to join. And just have fun. Spin right for your brain. If you're somebody who gets anxiety over seeing that much yarn, seeing that much drafted fiber over your arm, and it gets tangled in your spindles and it drives you up a wall, don't spin like that. Spin for your brain, spin for your sanity, and spin for your zen. And just take smaller pieces. I had a Spanish teacher once tell us, you know, ask us what's the best way to eat an elephant. And someone said, one small piece at a time. And he's like, exactly. So I parlay that to most of the things that give me anxiety when learning. And just doing it that way just helps my brain, especially with this merino. It's really been great to spin it like that. So, there's that. Now, I have shown you cop after cop after cop of this undyed merino. Really, I think I've only shown you one or two cops before. But the reason I keep on showing you is so you can see my progress. Now, this merino, you can see, if I put it against the black, you can see that it is just, it's getting better and better with each cop. And I'm happy. Sorry about that. It's getting fine and thin, and really, it's getting there. It's getting where I want it to be. And this is being spun on my bottom whorl spindle. And I'm loving it on this thing. Loving it. What I'll often do, because the bottom is pointy, is I'll spin it a little bit like a supported spindle, and I'll pretend that I have one of those, because I really want one of those in my real life. I need more spindles. For as much as I love spinning, I need more spindles. I've been watching a lot of Craft Stash, and she spins punies and rolags. And she just bought a blending board, and I want one of those so bad. Like, oh my gosh, the amount of fiber that I've been just totally, like, lusting after, and all of the ways of blending it and doing things differently. Like, I've totally thought, like, my love for spinning was there, but now it's become a real passion, and I really, really like just sitting there and playing with the fiber, and it's just become fun again. Like when I first started, it's just become fun again. And a lot of it, the props to that goes to Kim from Craft Stash, because she does a lot of stuff with fiber, and I've just really been inspired to continue going on with spinning and thinking about it in different ways and trying to stay, like, to push my comfort zone. But not so much to the point where I don't want to do it because it gets scary. So, that being said, that's one of the things that I've been working on. The other thing that I have been working on is, and this kind of will bleed into Stashy Stashy, because this is a recent acquisition, and you haven't seen it before, from me anyway. So, I heard that Sadie, who does the Yarn of War podcast, and has, she opened a store called Knitter's Nightmare. Now, when that happened, I kind of had to go out and get something that she was doing because, based on her personality alone, I thought that she would do colorways that were really, you know, that I'd be really into doing because I think we have a lot of similar tastes. So I thought that it would be really awesome to get a colorway from her. Now, granted, I think I should have held out for the Nightmare Before Christmas or the Labyrinth lines because really I got so lusty after those fibers. But I ended up getting Sunset on Gelfrey. And this was a 2 ounce, 2 ounces of wool fiber. And let me show you the other side because the other side looks a little different. So, after I finish this, I'll be halfway done with the first half. I did divide it in two. I don't know if I'm going to ply it. I'm afraid of plying. I'll be totally honest. I haven't tried it yet, but maybe I will ply it. And then, because I'm getting pretty fine singles, and I don't mean to, I wanted to spin this bulky. What I really wanted to do was spin this bulky. But because of the fact that I have been going through all this merino, I'm used to spinning fiber fine. And then I'm spinning on my top whorl. I'm spinning this on my top whorl. And the top whorls tend to go faster. Okay. So let's take this off here so I can show you. Oh, this is going to fall off. Crap. Okay, that's what you call not having enough twist in your fiber. But, see, it's coming out really, really fine. And I really wanted it more bulky. We're just going to put that right here. So this is what it's looking like. And it's been really enjoyable to spin. I think wool is going to be one of those things that I really, really enjoy spinning. I can lose hours toiling away with this particular fiber. And I will be completely happy to do so. So, there's that. I guess we'll go ahead and get into Stashy Stashy. So that way I can do this. And then I'll show you the merino that I have already set. And I made this. So, let's get into Stashy Stashy. Okay. So, I'm surprised that I'm staying this close to format without any show notes. I'm pretty proud of myself. Okay, so let's go ahead and start. I'll start with the newest. Well, I guess I sort of really can't start with the newest since I just showed you the Knitter's Nightmare I acquired. With, now, there's a reason I acquired this stuff. I was able to move, pay all of my expenses, get everything turned on and groceries and da 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 da. I don't know how, but it's almost like I kept on pulling in out of my wallet whatever money I needed, and I ended up having about $40 or so left over, and I was like, "You done good, kid. You deserve something." So, to sort of welcome spinning into my home, I decided to get some acquisitions, and it just so happened that's when Sadie was opening her store, and I acquired the wool Sunset on Gelfrey, and then I also, and I think it was just the colors. I didn't really pay attention so much to the fiber, but the colors just kind of got me, and I just really love the way that Sadie dyes her yarn. So I ended up getting some Night at the Genetic Opera, which is 100% superwash merino. Ha! More merino, which will so not be spun up anytime soon. But let me just go ahead and show you. This is 4 ounces. Look at those colors. Oh my gosh. It's so smushy. I'm actually sad for you because you don't have this to hold. And if you do, go squeeze it. It's so amazing. I love that blue. It's just so awesome. So awesome. So horribly, horribly awesome because I had to get it. So awesome. I love the way that she dyes her yarn. Oh, squishy! Okay. So I acquired that as well as Sunset, and I think I might wait until the day I am able to acquire a wheel to spin that merino so that it spins up beautifully, because I want to make something special out of that fiber. It just looks too damn cute. So I think I will wait, and that will be the first thing that I spin if I get a wheel soon anyway. So I got that. Now, before I even left my old house, I've been wanting some good rainbow fiber. And when Heather from Highland Handmaids, who also does the Fiberista Files podcast, when she introduced Bright's Rainbow, I had not been spinning yet. And I didn't know if I would. I knew I wanted to spin. I've always known since I was little that I wanted a spindle and to be able to spin. But when she did the Bright's Rainbow, I wasn't sure that I'd be able to do it yet because I had no confidence at all in crafting. So I did not get it. And I kind of kicked myself once I started spinning because it was a beautiful colorway. And I saw, I was watching Silly Fruit spin it. And Silly Fruit always has these beautiful rainbow colorways that she gets from people or that she buys or has gifted to her. And I'm so damn jealous. So, I was looking for rainbow fiber. No one was doing rainbow fiber at the time. Fiber Nymph said that she was thinking about it, but she was dying for a show, I think, and didn't have time to make the rainbow yarn. All the rainbow yarn she had made was for her show. All the fiber she had made was for her show. So, Sock Bunny, who is Kim from the Sock Bunny Knit and Fit podcast, she made a custom dyed colorway for me called The Promise. And this is 80% superwash BFL, 20% nylon. And it is so pretty. I am not a fan of how the red shows up on this camera, but it is beautiful in person. And this is on her Miracle Sock base. It is 400 yards, I think. Hold on. Yes, it's 400 yards. And it's a 2-ply. And again, it's from Sock Bunny Studios, and I believe you can find her on Etsy. And this will be a cowl or something for me. So I got that, and it's starting to get all wonky, so it needs to be taken out of the skein. I would like to cake that up, but I need a winder thingy. So there's that. And then finally, for my birthday, I met up with Chaotic Cooker, who is from the Chaotic and Crafty podcast. And she, I've known her IRL for like 20 years or so. So she gave me this for my birthday. This is from Maine Wool Yarns and Fiber. And you can find them at www.mainwoolyarns.com. This is 4 ounces in the Erin colorway. And it is pretty, pretty, pretty. I love spinning wool on drop spindles way more than I like spinning merino. I like spinning Corriedale. Like, I like the coarser fibers to spin on drop spindles. I don't know why. I like alpaca, too, which is not a coarse fiber. But I don't know why, but I really like spinning the coarse fibers on drop spindles. Don't know. So that's what I got for you. Give me 1 second because the battery is going to die and I need to plug it in before that happens. Sorry about that. I had to go plug in the computer. I'm surprised it's so late in the day and I actually have some pretty fairly decent light. It's been really, really cold over here, so the sun has just been not here, and it's been horrible to record shows here, which is why I said 2 weeks ago I was going to have a show. I haven't had a show because we've had no good light. So anyway, final thing that I wanted to show you, is in I Made This. So let's go ahead and get into I Made This. So the first cop of the Merino that I have been spinning on my drop spindle was done. I set it, I thwacked it, and I am so proud of it. And this has been hanging, back here for a little while now, and the way that I hung it was kind of so that it was stretched a little bit, so that it hung properly, like on a nitty knotty, but I don't have a nitty knotty. So, it was as hung as if it was on one, but it wasn't. But I will tell you this. This yarn is so balanced and so even that it hung. It hung straight. It didn't twist. A lot of my yarn that you guys have seen in the past, it would twist like this on itself. But this yarn, it just hung. It just hung. And that's the sign of beautifully balanced yarn. And I am so super proud of this. This is, again, the first cop of the Merino, and I will be naturally dyeing this for you guys, in pomegranate in another show to come. Look at that. I don't know the yardage on this. I'm guessing it's around 100. This is not very big. And this is two cops of the, let me try that again. This is the first two cops of the Merino that I spun. And how I combined those cops, I don't know, but I was not able to put the third one on. Which is why the first cop is still on my spindle. The third cop is still on my spindle. And plus, that cop is not that big. But anyway, so yeah, beautiful. I'm loving it. Let me just see if I can separate some of these for you. And I'm not wearing enough black to showcase it. I'm loving the way that it looks, and I'm going to not naturally dye this up, see how that works, do a tutorial, and you will have your natural dye thing going on. So yeah, I made that. I'm pretty proud of it. I would say that that is an epic pass faux show. So I think that is it. I'm looking around, trying to make sure I didn't forget anything that I wanted to show you. Yeah, that's it. Wow, I'm pretty proud of, how this show went, because I've done this a couple times before, and I've hated the way it looked, so today was just a good day, I guess. But yeah, there's been a lot of change in the past 7 months. I have done some knitting, done some spinning, and I'm pretty good. I'm pretty proud of my life right now. And hopefully this means good things for the show. I would really like to do a contest coming up. We'll probably do something in January. I would like to do my first pattern. So if you're a beginner and you've never done a pattern before, I really think it'd be an awesome idea if you guys want to join in. And so what I'm going to do is on the forum board on Ravelry.com under Chasing Spindles, I am going to put a thread that says my first pattern. And if you have never knit a pattern before, let's all try and decide which pattern we can do. If you're a beginner and you've never knit a pattern before, put one that you think that you would like, you think you would be comfortable doing. If you've knit before and you know of an easy pattern for beginners, go ahead and recommend it in there. And if you remember what your first pattern that you ever knit was, put that in there as well, and I'll just have it in there for us to talk about, and we'll knit that together. And maybe coming up in January, we'll do some sort of a contest with that. Also, I would like to still do our natural dye-along. I have not forgotten about that. As I mentioned earlier, I will probably be dyeing up the skein of merino that I washed, or that I spun, and I have some pomegranates, I've got some blueberries, I've got some stuff that'd be amazing to dye in, so It'll be my my Fruit Loops dye thingamajig. We'll see how it turns out. I think it'll be fun. So I'll post a tutorial on that shortly, and then we will go bonkers with natural dyeing like I promised you forever ago. Before I get out of here, I just want to do a couple of acknowledgments. First of all, I wanted to say thank you to Renicia. And I really am not certain how to pronounce your name. Please let me know if I'm pronouncing it wrong. I do apologize. She has sent me 2 letters asking where the show's been. And honestly, when you do a podcast and you're not one of the big names, you're just kind of a, you know, no-name podcaster, you have to do it for the love of podcasting and showing what you've made to people, because if you did it for the views, sometimes you'd get discouraged. And for me, I just do it because I like to podcast. But the fact that somebody took time out of their busy day and said, hey, where's your show? I really enjoy it. That means so much to me. It really, truly does. And I can't tell you, like, how humbling it is for somebody just to say, hey, I enjoy what you do. Like, that means so much to me. So thank you very much, Renicia. I am back. We are doing the full show again. And so, come back to the board. She said she had left when she thought the show was gone. But the show's back, so come back. So thank you very much for your support. Also, I wanted to say a thank you to Chaotic Hooker for all of her yarn donations, as well as to my friend Christina, who is not on Ravelry. So for your helping me start everything up, I just wanted to say thanks for just being there with all your advice and stuff. And yeah, so look for more shows to come. Next week, I will hope to have Sunset done, and I will hopefully be able to show you something that I've been working on for a very long time. Hopefully this week I'll work on putting it to bed. I don't know, I have a lot of train time, but I think it's a little too big for a train. We'll see. We will see. But until next time, you can find me again on Ravelry, Flirk, and Instagram as SpinPixie. You can find me on Facebook very soon. I'll be making a fan page for the show. And you can also find the blog with pictures and tutorials and show notes and the podcast on chasingspindles.blogspot.com, and of course right here on YouTube. So until next time, I will see you later, and keep on chasing spindles. Bye!